To apologize is to express remorse or regret for one's actions. I may apologize for not uploading videos for weeks at a time or for never checking my DMs, but an apology can also be a formal justification or a defense of something. A mathematician's apology is an essay written by English mathematician G.H. Hardy, in which Hardy provides a justification that mathematics has value even if it doesn't have practical applications. If you've seen my last video about the story of Ramanujan, you may remember that Hardy was the Cambridge professor who invited Ramanujan over from India to come and work with him. And if you've at all strayed into the philosophy of mathematics, you have likely come across Hardy's apology. He says, "I have never done anything useful. No discovery of mine has made or is likely to make, directly or indirectly, for good or ill, the least difference to the amenity of the world. I have helped to train other mathematicians, but mathematicians of the same kind as myself, and their work has been, so far at any rate as I have helped them to it, as useless as my own. Judged by all practical standards, the value of my mathematical life is nil, and outside mathematics it is trivial anyhow. I have just one chance of escaping a verdict of complete triviality, that I may be judged to have created something worth creating. And that I have created something is undeniable. The question is about its value." Hardy finds this value in the beauty of mathematics. He says, "The mathematician's patterns, like the painter's or the poet's, must be beautiful. The ideas, like the colours or the words, must fit together in a harmonious way. Beauty is the first test. There is no permanent place in the world for ugly mathematics." Hardy's specialty was in number theory, and he remarked it was a field that had particularly few practical applications, although that was before it became a prominent feature of cryptography or was used to crack codes. And perhaps that lack of obvious applications was one of the appeals for Hardy to number theory, that the mathematical truths were untainted by our reality. He says, 317 is a prime, not because we think so, or because our minds are shaped in one way rather than another, but because it is, because mathematical reality is built that way. In the book, he goes on to give a couple of examples of what he would call first-rate mathematics. These are proofs which are particularly beautiful and important, although he is constrained by giving a proof that a reader who might not have a lot of background in mathematics would also be able to appreciate. One such proof is from the Greeks, attributed to the Pythagoras group, and it is of the irrationality of the square root of 2. It's a proof that the square root of 2 cannot be written as a fraction of integers, which have no common factor. I will link to this page of proofs in the description, but the essence is that we use reductio ad absurdum. We set up a hypothesis that you can write it as a fraction of integers with no common factor. And we go through and see that if we did that, then both A and B could be shown to be even. But if they are both even, then they have a common factor of 2, and our hypothesis is false, meaning that the square root of 2 indeed cannot be written in this form. Hardy goes on to compare the kind of mathematical problem solving you might see in chess to these kind of serious proofs that we've just looked at. And Hardy says that the proof of Pythagoras is much more serious in that it has influenced thought profoundly, even outside of mathematics. The irrationality proof shows that when we have constructed arithmetic itself, it will not prove sufficient for our needs, since there will be things we will be unable to measure, for example, the diagonal of a square. The seriousness of the proof is what makes it beautiful, but it doesn't make it useful. Hardy says that this proof in particular is not particularly useful to anyone, since what would be useful to an engineer would be an approximation of the value. And he says, all approximations are rational. Another one of the proofs that Hardy describes as being very beautiful is one to do with there being an infinite number of prime numbers, although he acknowledges that this proof is also not useful. An engineer would have plenty of prime numbers to work with that are already known, and probably no one is wondering if they're about to run out of primes. But these proofs have brought great fame and respect to the mathematicians who wrote them. They might inspire you to want to pursue mathematics and want to be immersed in solving these very beautiful puzzles. From the outside, this book may seem like a happy celebration of mathematics, but that is not what it is. It is actually a somewhat depressing autobiography of Hardy, who at age 62 acknowledged that he was well past his prime, and he even considered his mathematical life to be over. He says, "Mathematics is not a contemplative but a creative subject. No one can draw much consolation from it when he has lost the power or the desire to create, and that is apt to happen to a mathematician rather soon. It is a pity, but in that case he does not matter a great deal anyhow, and it would be silly to bother about him." In this, Hardy is claiming that the best work of a mathematician is often done when they are young, and he feels that he has passed that time and can't go back. He has lost his desire to be creative, and he considers mathematics to be a creative field. Hardy also acknowledges that a lot of his best work was done through collaborations, notably with Littlewood and Ramanujan. He says, "I still say to myself when I am depressed and find myself forced to listen to pompous and tiresome people, well, I have done one thing you could never have done, and that is to have collaborated with both Littlewood and Ramanujan on something like equal terms." Even writing this book at all would have upset Hardy, because he acknowledges in one of the first few pages that he thinks talking about mathematics is a topic only for second-rate minds. I'd hate to know what he thinks of me talking about him talking about mathematics. But I'd like to end on a quote from the foreword, written by another mathematician who knew Hardy quite well, C.P. Snow. Snow spent time with Hardy in his final days. He saw Hardy in a depression when he lost his creative abilities, and he saw Hardy come to terms with this. He mentioned that the one thing Hardy did still have a passion and interest in was cricket. When he no longer cared about maths, he would ask Snow on every visit to just discuss the cricket scores with him. On the last day that Snow visited Hardy, he said there was an Indian test team playing in Australia, and we talked about them. It was in the same week that he told his sister, "If I knew that I was going to die today, I think I should still want to hear the cricket scores." And each evening that week before she left him, she read a chapter from a history of Cambridge University cricket. One such chapter contained the last words he heard, for he died suddenly in the early morning. I hope you have enjoyed that look at a mathematician's apology. A big thank you to my Patreon supporters who make my videos possible. If you can afford it, then please consider supporting me there as well. It's at patreon.com/tibees, and the link will be on screen and in the description. A special shout out to today's Patreon cat of the day, Rio, and thank you for watching. I hope to see you next time.